Roll call by the town clerk.
Chairman Cogsall?
Here.
Counselor Amaro?
Here.
Counselor Creelman?
Here.
Counselor Jordan?
Yeah.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Here.
Counselor Pearson?
Here.
And Counselor Reed?
Here.
I invite you all to join us in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
What?
For the approval of the minutes of meeting number 10-90-91, held January 14th, 1991, do we have any additions or corrections? There being none, I'll take a motion. Counselor Reed?
Madam Chairman, I move acceptance of the minutes of the January 14th, 91 meeting.
Second. All in favor? 7-0. The minutes of the special meeting number 11-1990-91, held January 28th, 1991.
Madam Chairman, I'll move they be accepted as printed.
Second.
All in favor? 7-0. The next item is citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there anyone who wishes to step forward and make a comment? If you would please identify yourself.
My name is Henry Adams, resident of Cape Elizabeth. I wish to compliment the town of Cape Elizabeth through the town council for the removal of an eyesore in the vicinity of 130 Ocean House Road. The fire department, if you remember, burned the structure down a couple weeks ago. As chairman of the Town Center Concept Subcommittee of the now expired Main Street 90 program, I would like to urge the town council to take action to remove another eyesore in town. I'm referring to the Girl Scout building across the street from the newly and tastily decorated Casco Northern Bank. Thank you.
Any other citizens who wish to come forward and make a comment? If not, we'll move on to reports and correspondence. I guess perhaps I will start with reminding everyone there is going to be a public hearing for the $1 million bridge once again. It'll be this Wednesday evening, the 13th of February at 7 o'clock p.m. in the council chambers in South Portland. Apparently there's been a complete revision in the design of the bridge, and for anyone who's interested, please feel free to come. Other reports and correspondence? Counselor Pearson.
It's not really a report of correspondence, just an observation today. For anyone that doesn't know, the Spurwink Church was the victim of a brutal assault by a car on Thursday, early Friday morning at 2 a.m. And I just bring that up for a couple reasons. One being maybe we can urge the State Department of Transportation to once again look at realigning that dangerous curve at the church to protect that from the future, especially during the season when there might be weddings and a vehicle might travel a little bit faster and further into that building, resulting in loss of life and property which can't be replaced.
Thank you. Other reports? Councilor McLaughlin.
Madam Chairman, I'd like to report that the Council Ordinance Committee continues to meet very diligently, and at our two January meetings, we dealt with some potential ordinance language relating both to daycare and to dead-end roads. These two items will be going to the planning board now for them to have review and public hearings on it before it comes back to the ordinance committee and then the full council. With the daycare language, what we're striving for in this is an intent to reduce the amount of review that is necessary for somebody who wants to operate a small daycare operation in a residential zone, and this would be for an operation that's for six or fewer children. And I know there are a number of people in town interested in that issue. I would urge them to stay in touch with the town planner and through the manager with the ordinance committee to check on the status of that. We do have an upcoming ordinance committee meeting this Wednesday, the 13th, where we will be discussing, thank you, the wetlands ordinance. We have promised that we will revisit that. We plan to do that this week. If anybody has additional information regarding the relatively new wetlands ordinance, we would appreciate that kind of input. We expect to have something referred to ordinance committee this evening. We also will begin a discussion of communication towers. That's the recent activities of ordinance committee. I'm hoping all of the counselors either received today or shortly will receive from Greater Portland Council of Governments information about the upcoming legislative exchange, which is on Thursday, February 28th at the Wyndham Town Hall. I know Councilor Amro attended one of these earlier this winter. It's a good opportunity to meet with counselors from different towns and basically share views on some very common problems, getting together as well with state legislators, and urge fellow counselors to attend that. I also want to say to the very many of you who missed a wonderful event yesterday, let's hope it happens again and we'll get more of us there next year. This is the Arts Commission had a Mardi Gras jazz event yesterday afternoon at the Cape Library. Councilor Creelman and some of his family were there. I was there. It was fantastic, really good music, and the spirit was added to a bit by a couple of youngsters who came with Mardi Gras masks. So those of us who were there had a good time, and I compliment the Arts Commission for sponsoring that.
Any other reports and correspondence? We as a council received a postcard from Lieutenant Tim Hare, who is a Cape Elizabeth relative. I don't know how many of you realize that the council sent Christmas cards to those who were in the armed services, and it was just his response thanking us for our support and for remembering him when he was away from home during the holidays. Debbie, did you have an announcement you wanted to make?
Yes. Nomination papers for those who wish to run for a town council and school board will be available in the town clerk's office beginning Thursday, February 21st. Those nomination papers would be due by the end of business on Tuesday, April 2nd. So anyone who is interested in running for the council and the school board, please get in contact with me. I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have. The election itself will be held the first Tuesday in May, which will be May 7th.
Thank you. We'll move on to the next item, which is a public hearing, the Public Works Improvements Project. Mr. McGovern, would you like to give us some background?
Be happy to, Madam Chairman. The Public Works Improvements Project has been in the planning stages for 4 or 5 years now. Several years ago, it was identified that there were a number of issues that ought to be addressed in the Public Works garage. Chief among them were a number of code deficiencies that was felt needed to be updated. Second, there were some issues involving some of the employee space issues as well as safety issues involving public access. Tonight, the architects are here, the Design Alliance will be presenting to you and to the public a proposed program for improvements. In addition, Bob Malley is here, the Director of Public Works, to answer any questions you may have. Members of the Municipal Facilities Committee, who recommended that a project be undertaken, led by the committee chairman, Irv Chappell. Ernie McVane, who is the Code Enforcement Officer, is here with respect to any questions members of the public may have on code deficiencies. And in addition, Carl Pearson, a member of the Town Council, videotaped some of the conditions at the Public Works garage, and perhaps it might be appropriate to start with Councilor Pearson's presentation so that everyone who hasn't been in the garage has a sense of the conditions that are present there. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I was going to say, all those at home can't probably see, which is good, but I just want to put a word of thanks to the public cable, Cape Elizabeth Public Cable, for allowing me the use of their video equipment for this film. And please excuse the film itself, as I am not a professional filmmaker. And I'm going to try to narrate here because I did not have time to make a soundtrack to go along with it. But I think a picture's worth a thousand words, and I think that this will say volumes. As you can see, though, we're going to start off, and Town Manager Michael McGovern and I decided to take one of the warmest days of the year to go on a tour of the Public Works Garage. And here you can see that the town manager's car really flies. We're coming with a bird's eye view of the Public Works Garage. And that's the famous brick building with the green stripe that everyone knows so well. Here we finally landed, and it was a smooth touchdown. But this basically, for those who haven't come off Route 77, this is the way that the Public Works Garage looks out over the other town facilities, the schools, and there's the employee parking for the Public Works Garage. And we come right around to let's make a deal and decide which door to take to go into Public Works. And the town manager chose door number 3. And we enter into the service bay at the Public Works Garage, which, as you can see, is definitely a service bay. But it also has other functions. This particular service bay is the employee locker room and the refreshment center, ventilation center, and mechanical center. Occasionally, I may fast forward on you here, too, because the town manager might say that I'm directing that camera at his cups of coffee. It was cold.
In the garage?
In the garage. And everywhere. We went on a complete facilities tour that day. There we are, the Stairway to Heaven. That's the way up to the Director's of Public Works office, which we'll go there a little bit later, but first we're going to take a tour of the other facilities that are available to the Public Works employees. This is just, the town manager is going to turn on the lights, and we'll let these pictures speak for itself. These, by the way, are the only facilities on the ground floor for the Public Works employees. And as you can see, we now go into the employees' lounge, washroom, and during snowstorms, their bunkhouse. This houses approximately 18 employees during a snowstorm or other type emergency situations, or if they happen to have the same lunch break at the same time. But it does come with a view. We're not going to spend too much time in here, so I'm just going to fast forward it so that we can go and see the director's wonderful office. So excuse me at home if this image isn't real clear, but it's kind of hard to broadcast a broadcast. Oops. There we are. We have the storage facilities for the equipment back into the bay, and I believe we're going to approach that wonderful stairway. There we go, the roving camera. These stairs, if no one's been there, I'd say probably close to a 60-degree pitch. And it's probably about 2 feet wide. And this is the director's office, the foreman's office, the clerk's office. And as you can see by Bob's example, there's lots of headroom. But essentially, this is the brain center of Public Works. This is where the director sits. The clerk of the works, if you will, all the maps, all the office facilities, the foreman's desk, and this is where all the paperwork gets done, all the engineering studies are held, all the maps, all the charts, Anything that you've ever wanted to know about Cape Elizabeth is right here. Now, just for time-wise, we're going to zip out of here because I think it doesn't take long to go around this room a couple times. And we'll exit out the back door, which this now takes us. And I'm going to turn up, no, I'm not going to turn up the volume, because this particular area right here is right over the large garage, which if you go by the Public Works garage, will show you three large garage doors in the front facing police and fire department. This is the storage facility for dry goods. It also, as the town manager will soon help us here for display purposes, is the sign shop, where all the shops are spray painted and made for the various locations around town. This is where all the spare parts are kept, all rubber hoses, anything that has to be kept high and dry. And later on, you'll just see how high and dry this particular spot is. There we are, a bird's eye view of the lower level. And there it is. That's the sign shop. Oops, the town manager has found a treasure. Oh, wouldn't that feel nice on a 10 below zero? And it is a dead end. And that's the same cup of coffee. But we're going to speed along here. I don't know if we can get a shot. There were a few army carts up on top there in that dock area, and those are sometimes taken down to that wonderful employee lounge and spread out during snowstorms. The back stairway here is probably about 55 degrees, so it's a little bit easier climbing down, and it's about 30 inches wide. And here's all those trucks that we usually see gracing the streets of Cape Elizabeth. Prepared for the snowstorm that never came. This is just another facility where they work on the larger pieces of equipment. The other bay has the lift, and that's where they work on the school buses and other vehicles that have to be lifted off the ground. This is just a quick tour of the storage space for signs, for equipment, and miscellaneous public work supplies. I'm going to speed ahead again here in hope of saving time, just to show you one other aspect of this project which will be dealt with and is in the plans. This just goes once again for a tour of the facilities. And there we have recreational facilities for the town employees. And also up there behind the backboard was where the storage area right there is suspended from the ceiling beams. So that's fully self-supported off the ceiling beams, which is structurally sound but not too accessible for anyone that might have any kind of ailments or handicaps. And there's our second locker room. Now we're just going to speed ahead one more time here so that the architects have their chance to present. Oops. Now this thing doesn't shut off, so I'm in trouble. We're going to rewind a little bit. I just wanted to point out this is one of the structural deficiencies in the building right here, where there's cracking due to stress, and that whole block corner has to be repaired. And then the infamous door number one. And the infamous green door number two and door number three. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councillor Pearson. That's very informative for those who were not able to attend the open house. I'd like to recognize Barry Stallman, the from Design Alliance, who has prepared the all the information for the improvement project.
Can I be heard without the microphone? I think there are two issues that struck us when we started to look at this building. First is the site, and the second of all is the building itself. Those of you that have traveled Jordan Way and going between the two school complexes, it's pretty much a free-for-all when you get to the corner of the stop sign. There's no edge to particular properties at all. There's no definition between what's for the public, what is the public works department, where is their turn. And a third element is there's a lot of Bob school children that are walking past between the two buildings, about the two buildings, and really returning to the public works department and the public safety building. There are lots of kids that are going on there and the IGA and the school. So the first concern when we were looking at the building was for the site and what needed to have happen to the site to make it safe to go up.
So first I'm going to talk about the site aspects of the design, and I will point out that we have just received, and I read tonight, Bill Bray has been hired by the town to prepare a traffic report, and that report has been prepared, and there are possibly some modifications that may come out of that report, and we've not had time to discuss that with the council, the town manager, or Bob Malley, or any of the other players that are going to be necessary to be informed about the traffic. Routes on this drawing, is this drawing showing up? Can everybody see it? Route 77 is here. The shopping complex is here. This is your public safety building, the elementary schools, the existing public works building that you just saw, and right here is the high school parking lot. As it stands now, traffic comes in off of Route 77 and either moves on to the elementary school complex or takes a left at a stop sign approximately right here and goes down towards the high school. What we're proposing is to close off Jordan Way in this location, with the exception of some kind of electronically controlled access for safety vehicles. And that would be probably placed right in this direction and be controlled by your dispatcher in the public safety building. The existing road, which is here, would be swung over into this location to create one, a definite edge between vehicular traffic and the public works department. That would be, it is proposed to be lined with some sort of trees, which has not been designed at this point, probably something in the conifer line so that they would be green year round. We've also proposed to provide parking adjacent to the ball field. People do park for the ball field, and employees for the Public Works Department park in this area now. And as I understand it, for ball games, they park on the grass and all around that area. We're proposing to provide some parking directly here for the ball field and for the employees during the daytime. The addition to the building occurs in this location here on the west side of the building, and it's really the only place that an addition can safely be put on to this existing building. Currently there are bay doors at both the north and south end of the existing building, and traffic must pass through the building or at least come in one end and come out the other end, so that access is important for the proper functioning of this department. As Councilman Pearson told you earlier, access to this building is nearly impossible to find out which door to go in. Currently, this is the existing building. One either wanders through one of the three bay doors in the front or the rear, or in one of three doors that exist along the side of the building. Our proposal would create a proper front door to the building with an entrance, a very small area for people to wait while they're waiting for the director or to see somebody else in the department. The clerk would be there to greet someone and to maintain control over the building. And I think one of the primary things this building provides for the department is handicapped accessibility for the public as well as any workers in the future, and provides proper places for the workmen to eat their lunch, to take a break, to spend their time when they're here for 24 hours during snow emergencies. It provides proper men and women's facilities on the first floor. It provides a locker area, provides shower areas for both men and women, provides a map room, which, as you saw in the video, is currently in the director's office and is scattered hanging on the wall and under one of the drawing boards that he has in his office. And you'll find that much more proper storage can be maintained for these documents in a map room, and the access to the public will be more convenient. There will be a conference room also located directly near the front door. Part of this project will also provide for the proper renovation of the existing building. We'll provide ventilation for carbon dioxide gases, which are now emitted from the vehicles. It will also take care, through the use of portable welding exhaust fume device that will get rid of the heavy metal exhaust when welding takes place within the shop areas. It will get rid of the toileting that's improper. It will upgrade the electrical systems that are now barely able to sustain the load that's being placed upon them. It will clean up the the area that you saw that was being utilized for the workman's break room. That will be cleaned up, gutted, and restructured for storage. The stairway, which I think the congressman said the stairway to heaven, was that correct? that stairway will be abandoned, which will provide better access and more safety, and better safety for the men that are working in this newer bay right here. It will also eliminate the vending machines and lockers that are currently located along this wall, and will really return it to being a proper and safe work area. And the public will really not be in this area at all. Public will come in the front door, they will see the director or whomever they're there to see, conduct their business, and will leave. Then there will be a direct access at the rear of the building for the workmen to come in. The workmen will not be using the front door. I think I will stop the presentation there at that point. The exterior of the building, as you can see, and wait, one more comment on the exterior. We would upgrade the structural defects, which are at all four of the outside corners. Those defects are being caused by expansion and contraction of steel that is expanding and contracting and is not being allowed to slide properly and is pushing the exterior wall and causing severe cracks. Particularly this one bearing wall here is really being blown apart, and the ice and water gets inside and freezes and thaws, causing further deterioration. The existing building will be painted, and the new building will be matching block and will be both will be upgraded, so that I think you'll have a complex within the town that you can be proud of, and one that should provide extremely good service for the years to come. Be as maintenance-free as one can make buildings today.
Are there any questions of Mr. Stallman?
Just had one quick question about the area of the cinder blocks that where the mortar has, in a sense, come apart on all four corners, I guess, through the freezing and then heating and contracting. The sophistication of the mortar and cinder block in 1962, is this improved any in 1991, given your proposal for the new addition? Will be cinder block also to match the entire structure?
It'll be a concrete block rather than a cinder block, and there is an upgrading of that material since the era when this was built. The real issue here, though, and why it's destroying itself, is the fact that the steel cannot, when it expands, which it does when it gets warmer, it's pushing into the block, and there's no way for the structure to with the beam that sits on top of the column, it's a rigid connection, and it's pushing itself this way, and as it does, it flexes against the block, causing cracks to open up. If this piece was allowed to slide and then not push into block, then you would have no deterioration on the masonry. That's what's really happening.
Other questions? Are there any questions from members of the public? Well, if not, then do we have any statements from anyone? I know Mr. Chappell's here, who is chairman of this committee. Do you wish to make any statement at all?
No, just that I'm all for it.
Okay. Councilor Reed.
Madam Chairman, I would like the public to know that although it appears as though the councilors on this side cannot see what is going on, we have had a presentation and we do have smaller drawings of exactly what you're seeing at home. So we're not distracted. We are seeing everything that you're seeing. Thank you.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you. I would like to follow up on what Councilor Reed said and just reiterate that the council has viewed this presentation in a workshop session, at which time we asked many, many questions of the presenters. I do have some questions of Bob Malley, if that's appropriate.
Yes. Mr. Malley, would you like to come up to the microphone, please?
You and I talked this afternoon about some of the recommendations in the traffic impact evaluation, and I told you at that time I had some concerns about the configuration being presented. Mr. Stallman has alluded to that alignment a bit tonight, saying that there hasn't been time for coordination between his office and the traffic engineer who did the report. But just so everybody will know the context that you and I discussed this afternoon, we'll have our discussion in public now. Some of the evaluation proposes moving the employee parking from adjacent to the ball field and putting it in closer to the building. And we talked about turning radii that were needed in there. Have you had a chance to look at that?
Yes, I did. I did take a look at that, and you know, the concerns that we talked about this afternoon with it, one, that we have a definition between employee parking and municipal vehicle movements, and that we wanted to make sure that the two weren't conflicting with each other, and that's why we put the employee parking where we did at the time, that there would be that separation and there wouldn't be this problem of having, you know, private vehicles within the garage site and having the tendency for them maybe to get hit or what have you, or just plain be in the way. So that's why we put it where we did. The alignment that Bill Bray did, he showed 11 spaces in his alignment, and the Design Alliance configuration showed 18 spaces. And looking at that, we really need, in the event of a snow emergency, we really need 17 spaces as a minimum. So the 18 figure is really right where it should be. I think that provided for one extra spot, but we really can't do with less than that. If we do, we have to put some vehicles down back towards the shopping center.
That's what he did on his. I now see it.
Seven
down there. So there's the 18 provision.
And that can be a bad spot just for snow removal and other purposes. So it's, you'd kind of like to have everything grouped together if you could. Mm-hmm. But again, we really haven't had time to talk this over, so it's new to us and new to you. So.
Okay. I just want to go on record as putting forth some of my concerns with the two alignments. The alignment that Mr. Bray shows, for my liking, comes much too close to the clump of oak trees. Those are very special to some of us who've spent a lot of time in the fields in that area. I think they're very distinctive trees. You told me this afternoon there's a lot of ledge near those trees. I know we're going to find ledge throughout this site. That's a given. But I would like us to stay as far away from the oak trees as possible. I was saying something this afternoon like splitting the difference between the Design Alliance alignment and Mr. Bray's alignment. And I would really like, I hear what you're saying, Bob, about your concerns, and I know they're very valid. I would like us, my preference would be for us to have the employee parking within the site, not across over by the ball field. I want also, I think the provision for the new bleachers is a good idea. I would like us to be able to keep that, which it does not appear we would be doing with that bleacher location anyway, with Mr. Bray's configuration. We also talked about the access from the access road between the schools, having an access entry exit from that into the public works area, basically across from the maintenance shed. Why don't you give us some of your reasons why or why not that is
okay. The
good.
Original thinking behind that was that it would provide an access for the school buses to come in and fuel up without having to go out onto 77 or Scott Dyer and come in through the garage that way onto Jordan Way. So it would provide an entrance for that and also for our own use for plowing. The problem behind that was that through signage, we would try to discourage traffic from the high school from skirting up through the garage complex, but in reality, we know that potentially could be a problem. So unless you have a police officer there or try to enforce it, you know, it is a point where vehicles could come through there. So I think, you know, your concerns are valid. You know, we may want to look at closing that right up altogether, and it would just make it a little bit inconvenient for the school buses to come in from Jordan Way, but I don't see that as a big problem.
Okay.
You know, we're going to be coming in that way anyway with our own transfer trailers or mm-hmm. or fuel tankers to fill up the gas pump, so if the buses have to come in, I don't see that as a big problem.
Okay. And I don't know if this is a question best directed to you or to somebody else this evening. I'd like to know what kind of input we've had from the school department about the proposed realignment and reconfiguration for circulation.
They are aware of the plans. We are going to be going over with them in detail probably this week on them, but they are aware of the configuration. They do not have a problem with that basic configuration. They are concerned just about traffic movements within the whole complex itself. So they, you know, we need to keep in touch with them. But I think the basic idea they are in favor of. I talked with Dee LaBelle today about it, so he seems pretty confident that they can work with us. And as long as they can go from school to school, that's really their main concern.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And they should well be concerned with some of the traffic circulation that they have. And I say that as a parent who drives between the middle school complex and the high school complex. And
their
I know
biggest
it,
concern
it's like.
Was that they're fearful of a lot of the high school traffic exiting up through Pond Cove. when buses are picking up kids. So that's, I think that's their biggest concern right now.
It's a valid concern. I know the speed at which we try to get someplace on time. If you're driving a high school student, or if you're a high school student driving to get to the school when it starts in the morning, I know the speed at which I travel. And some of it does go through the elementary complex. It is a real concern in the afternoon when you've got the younger children out there and high school students trying to get to that end of town. I think this is something that can be handled administratively, and I think we can have some enforcement going on. That's also an issue with the parking on the access road right now, that we have signs there and it's not always enforced.
One of the things that we talked about today was putting signage at the exits of the student parking lot, the upper student parking lot, that would say left turn only. Mm-hmm. So that traffic would have to come out the main entrance of the high school onto 77 and could not go up through the middle school area.
But other traffic on that access road could?
Yeah, it's just an idea of eliminating some of the traffic volume. Yeah.
Okay. I know these are things we can deal with. I just want you to know my concerns. I'm delighted to hear that there will be the emergency access between Jordan Way and the middle school Pond Cove complex. That, you know, that was one of my conditions for feeling favorably towards this. It didn't make sense not to do that. And I know that can be worked, the type of access there can be worked out. Those are my questions right now. Thanks, Bob. Thanks for looking
into. Any other questions from counselors? I know, still in conjunction with this traffic pattern, if the traffic was rerouted for the left-hand turn only onto the upper student parking lot, it has been proposed that the main mall sort of exit be widened so that it would accommodate left and right turning traffic.
Correct.
Isn't that correct? And to be able to have the cars reach this particular street without having to pass school buses or be delayed by school buses who are picking up students. So that is also in part of the plan.
Right.
Other questions? Councilor Jordan.
Yes, I have a couple of things that I just want to point out that I'm in favor of the garage, but I would like to find a way that we could still get the garage and the facilities and reduce some of the outside work and have it done by the public works. And I would like to get into that later on, but I'll go into my idea of what I looked at as far as a park, and I was amazed with this report, the number of vehicles that go in and out there in the morning. I was really amazed by those numbers. But the one problem that I see with parents coming in the morning and dropping a student off at the high school or the elementary school and then going down to the other school one way or the other. And I think you're going to see more traffic through that access road than people realize, considering the number of vehicles that go in and out as they have put down in this survey. And as Councilor McLaughlin said earlier, those oak trees there are kind of a landmark there, and it looks to me so that they're going to do a number on the corner of them by the way these lines go. Now, I could be wrong, or I didn't read the lines correctly, and I would hope that things could be moved around so they wouldn't be disturbed. I agree that I think you need that area there so the buses can come and swing in there to the garage without going out on to 77. I think if there's any way possible, we ought to try to cut down the amount of traffic within the complex that has to go out onto 77 and then come back into the school complex. With people dropping them off and picking them up, they can get from one place to the other. But I think there's going to be a lot more traffic there than people realize. And it shouldn't be just a small town road, as I'll put it, old time road. It should be a well made road. And I don't know if this time is a time to get in on the bucks time, the dollars and cents, or are we going to be able to do something about this later on?
We can do that after we close the public hearing. This is still the public
hearing.
Okay.
That's all I have as far as traffic at this point.
Any other questions? Other comments? Is there anyone else who wishes to make a statement? Mr. Adams.
Again, as chairman of the Town Center Concept Subcommittee of the now expired Main Street 90 program, we labored long and hard for a little over a year on the Town Center. As you know, we've improved or had and facilitated the improvements of the traffic islands, Casco Northern Bank, the mobile station, the real estate office. We're still working on reconfiguring parking in the shopping center. One of our biggest concerns was the Public Works garage. We felt that the study was underway. We knew that some good would come from it, so we did not pursue it in any of our deliberations, but we left it to the study that was the Municipal Facilities Committee to come up with an idea for improving the Public Works garage, so that on behalf of the now expired Main Street 90 Committee, I want to let you know that we heartily endorse the improvements that have been presented here this evening. Thank you.
Thank you.
Richard Hall, Shore Acres, Cape Elizabeth. It seems every time I come before this council, which is getting to be frequently, that I preach restraint. I just want to remind you, before you go into deliberations on this, we're in a time of recession, and if this project is going to affect our tax base with a great deal, I would hope you would consider very carefully before you go building a lot of new buildings, or one new building. I've lived in this town quite a while, and the town hasn't grown over 1,000 people since I lived here. And it seems like you're increasing the size of your garage and facilities in respect to the size of the town. Now, I know everybody likes to have a new building to work out of, but these are very hard times now, and if it's going to affect our tax base, we want to be very careful. I agree with the town that the safety part of this has got to be corrected, of course. But before we go into any major building program at this time, I'm not saying in the future we shouldn't do it, but at this time I would think very carefully. Thank you.
I was going to keep quiet, but you don't mind a couple minutes, will you?
No, Mr. Chappell, we'd love to hear you.
I figured that the report that we gave you about 9 months ago would be sufficient from our committee, and I'm certainly pleased with what the group have taken over our recommendations and worked out this program for the highway department. I don't think the new building has too much to do with it. I don't think that the Jordan's Way, I don't think the planting, I don't think the parking, those I think can all be resolved in between the council and the highway department. I have full faith in both of them. My big concern is, one, it's about time we started to think about OSHA. It's about time that we started to think about these men that do our plowing, do our repairing, fill our sides of our roads, do the cleanup, cut the trees, and work long hours, especially during storms. One toilet, my goodness, it's appalling. It absolutely is. I wouldn't use it. Now, you can say that that's who's he think he is, but I wouldn't use it. And they have had this for quite a while. And they have done marvelously. How many of them have you seen out here with placards out in front of the town hall here saying we want better living conditions? They deserve better living conditions, and we haven't got to worry about the tax rate, for goodness sake. Put it on a bond and pay for it over the next 20 or 25 years, and we won't even feel it. We should do this, and we should do it now, and not 1 year, 2 years from now, but start tomorrow morning. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments?
Clint Blood and Hillcrest Road. I have no qualms with the building. In fact, I certainly would hope we would make it safe for Bob Manley to go to work, as far as that's concerned. My concern is, are we transposing those concerns, making those, taking care of those against the safety of our children. Earlier I was watching TV and Councillor Pearson was talking about the accident at Spurwink Road and taking measures to protect people there. My question is, are we now taking measures here to correct the building but then placing people at risk? And that's really our children. If in fact, as the discussion was tonight, make a left-hand turn for high school students, have you ever been there when school lets out, there are buses lined up. That means in order to get out, they've got to go around a bus on the pass on the opposite lane to get out of school. I have a real concern about that. I have a son who was just in an accident recently. Teenage drivers tend to get in a few more accidents than maybe some of the rest of us. If, in fact, they all go out the same exit, all at the same time, how much patience do all these teenagers have? It's not a building that has ongoing kinds of traffic, even flow, all the time. It's kind of like an industry, a factory, where everybody leaves at the same time, everybody comes at the same time. And it seems to me that what we're doing here is putting in a building which is great. We need it. But isn't there any other configuration which will allow us to have better traffic flow? You're really promoting having a number of people, including parents, drive through the elementary school on a regular basis. Because if you live in Northern Cape and you're coming down, the only way you can get out on a busy time will be driving through the middle school and the elementary school complex. So my concern is, and I'm sorry I haven't seen the traffic study, and I just got here a little bit late, and they said it hadn't been incorporated in the report or whatever. But I would really be concerned about approving it, the design as it is now, because of the safety issue for our children. Thank you.
That was, I don't know if you were here when I was talking to Mr. Malley about the realignment and the widening of the mall driveway so that cars could exit without going by the buses. The buses would be perhaps loading in another area. And you'd have left and right turning lanes, which you don't have now. And that's one of the reasons why people come out the other way, is because they don't want to wait for one car to have to cross the traffic. And the safety issue, I think, was sort of addressed in that children, the younger children, sometimes walk from school over to the shopping center through that whole area that's not all that well defined. So they are considering that as part of this process. And I also want to remind everyone that this whole project still has to be approved by the planning board, and they will also take into consideration the traffic pattern and other safety issues as well. So the final approval will be with the planning board. We would be approving the project, in essence, the money, which is tentatively scheduled to be included as part of a big bond that we're not a bond, not a big one. looking at my budget, it's a big bond. A bond, and by including this in the bond, we also get a better rate, and it might affect the tax rate by as little as 4 cents this next year. So that's the reason why we're having the discussion tonight. Are there any other comments? Mr. McGovern.
Madam Chairman, members of the council, I would like to address myself a little bit to the comments involving the traffic study. I think Mr. Blood's comment is certainly valid, and I think your comments are as well, in part in response to Mr. Blood. The traffic study, as you know, we just received late Friday. I do want to apologize to the council for what I would consider to be incomplete staff work on that particular report. I myself didn't really have a chance to sit down and read it until this morning, just before the department heads meeting. I share quite a few of the concerns of Councillor McLaughlin with some of the specific proposals in the Bray report. I also share the concerns that Bob Malley has about some of the traffic within the Public Works garage site. Because you wanted that report tonight, and you know, we really didn't have a chance to fully review it. What I'd like to do, and I think as Bob has suggested, is to spend some more time to specifically review it with the Public Works crew, with the school department, and as well with the planning board. Next Tuesday night, we've preliminarily scheduled a pre-application conference with the planning board to get their suggestions and ideas on this project. What I would hope is that the council would recognize that we don't have a perfect solution yet to the issue of traffic. We have a lot of theories out there about what would best work, but I think there is one bottom line that's important to be looked at, and that is, as you look at the Brea report, perhaps some of the most important comments in there and some of the most important analysis is what is the level of service that we're going to end up with at different intersections. And I think as you look at that particular section of the report, he lists about 15 different actual intersections. At all except for two, the level of service will stay the same. What the level of service is how fast traffic gets in and out. There is one intersection that the level of service would decline, and if I don't have my notes in front of me, but if I recall right, that's up at the intersection of Jordan Way, excuse me, up at the intersection of Shore Road, Scott Dyer, and Route 77. An issue he points out that it's already in the funding plans for signalization anyway, and is already below the level of service that it ought to be. In addition, as a result of this work, there'd be one other intersection amongst the whole complex that would have an improved level of service. So we're not, I think what his study showed is we're not looking at any particular intersection other than one where we already know we have a problem that will have a negative effect. All of the level of services will stay the same. So what I would like to suggest is, you know, if the council is otherwise in favor of the project, that you approve the bond, but that you condition your final approval on this project to ultimately what the planning board comes up with, and that you would also need to approve that particular site plan. I'd be very hesitant for the council to say this is the way it has to be and then go to the planning board and find that, you know, they want it somewhere different. I would guess they'll have a lot of comments on this and suggestions, and you know, if the council still wants to keep their finger in it, which I can understand you probably would, you know, you could condition it upon it returning to you once the planning board has come up with their proposed outline. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments?
Edmund Capano, Spillink Avenue. At one time, the transfer station area was given consideration for building a new town garage. Has any consideration been given to that?
Mr. McGowan.
Yeah, in the early deliberations of the Municipal Facilities Committee, that was looked at. It was abandoned for essentially two reasons. Excuse me. One is the fact that the cost to put an entirely new garage up on that site with fueling facilities, et cetera, would probably be somewhat in excess of $1 million. They felt that it would be a much more costly project. Second, there was a concern that there is actually very little land up there that is not filled. A good part of the land is filled, so as a result, you know, you're under the DEP regulations, you're not allowed to place any new buildings or structures on filled land, so that not to mention the settling problem, so there's a real issue there. The third issue that came up during the municipal facilities planning process was a sense that it's helpful to keep a strong municipal center, and that tastefully done is still a wise place to keep it, so that it's handy to the town hall, it's handy to the school buses because all the school maintenance is done in the garage, it's handy to the police cars because all the police car maintenance is done, and just for the ease of communication and transportation. So it was looked at to place it at the refuse disposal area, as well as you know, generally other sites were looked at in town, and for the reasons I stated, the committee suggested that that location is the optimal location.
The area where the sand pile is all solid ground. There is no fill there, to my knowledge. The fill is further in.
But I think if you look at that particular area and recognize you still need to have the transfer station there really isn't the expanse to put a facility of this size.
That you go in through the gate
You're talking about on the left?
Yes.
Okay, I thought you were talking about the sand pile on the right.
No, on the left, as you go in through the gate, where the sand pile, not the salted sand pile, the sand pile that everybody enjoys.
You do have a lot of ledge there.
Yes, but ledge that's probably problems. Good.
Well, not for a good flat surface. We just put underground oil storage tanks over at the Public Works Garage about 2 years ago, and the blasting bill alone was, for one tank, was $7,000 to $8,000, so. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that area was looked at in general. I can't say every specific site.
I'm also concerned with young people going by that building, and one of the reasons why I would like to see the town garage moved up where the transfer station is, I don't know what you got for chemicals in that building. I don't know what will explode at any given moment, and that is a concern for me. I don't have children in the school system anymore, but it is a concern, and I don't know how well vented the gasoline tanks are that are underground, and what is the possibility, it may be one in a billion, but just the same, if it does happen, it could be catastrophic, and that really does concern me, because I know the children walk all over that place, and I think if it's within reason and all possible, we ought to consider another area. That building, for example, if we left it, could be used for a number of things. And I don't know if it could be converted to a school building or not, but it certainly could be used for something else. And if it were, it might solve some of the problems that we have as far as buildings are concerned. But I am concerned about the chemicals that we do have stored there, and I, for one, hope that we don't have to worry about anything that is going to be, at one time, a possible problem for us. And I also, one more thing, yes. And I think Councilor Greenlaw mentioned this, but I also don't want to see land taken away from the ball field side for pedestrian way. I think we ought to leave that just as it is, save our foliage and our vegetation and what have we, but do not take any more of that land, because that's a very small distance between the road or the parking spot and the ball field's fence. And if you restrict that, I think we're going to someday regret it. Thank you.
Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, I don't want anyone watching to be worried about the chemicals at the Public Works Garage. We have been in the process of replacing our underground gasoline storage tanks, and we do have monitoring devices there that measure the flow. I don't know if you've been in the Public Works Garage recently, Mr. Capano, but there's a panel there on the wall that gives certain readouts on it. Beyond that, the chemicals are, you know, what you'd expect to find in a garage, but you know, I'm sure they're no more dangerous than the chemicals you'd find, the cleansing agents and other things that are over at the schools themselves.
Any other comments from the public? If not, I'll close this part of the public hearing, and we'll move on to our consideration of the project, which is item number 132, to consider the comments on the proposed improvements to the Public Works Garage and the draft bonding resolution and take any necessary action. Do I have comments from any of the councilors? Councilor Jordan.
It was all right if I answer a little bit for Mr. Capano, to think of the chemicals that's in the hardware store. They may not be the quantity, but there's probably some a lot worse and what's in that Public Works Garage, if they still have anything as far as working on the home garden and what have you, there's probably some pretty good chemicals in there. And what I would like to know is, do we get another shot at the cost of this project? I'm in favor of the project, but I think it could be scaled back a little bit. And if I sit here and vote for a $400,000 bond issue, am I tied to that $400,000?
Mr. McGovern.
The next shot you would have is when we awarded the bid. And, you know, the bid can be established with certain items delineated as expenses. You know, if you have a concern about a particular item, we can have that listed in the bid as an option and have the cost spelled out and have the council, if you desire, vote on that option.
Because I feel that things are kind of tight out there, and I think we got to be careful as far as spending goes. And I understand what Councilor Coggeshall said earlier, that is only going to represent about 24 cents, about 4 cents this year as far as the taxes go. And for me to sit here and not know what the school is coming in and have a idea that I feel the increase should be this year is from 0 and 5% is the tops. I would like to know a little bit more of what this project actually is going to cost, because I'm not here to cut out a program in the school system to build a garage this year. Maybe it'd have to wait another year. And that's why I asked the question about when would a guy get another shot at it, because I feel some of this outside work could be done with our own people and we could save some money there.
What is the feasibility of some of the exterior work, grading, et cetera, being done by the town? Mr. McGovern?
There is some of it that could be done, but you know, I'd want to reserve comment fully on that until I looked at what the planning board finally approved. You know, it depends on how complex it gets, but you know, Public Works could do some of it, but you know, a lot of it is fixed costs, certain commodities, paving. Otherwise, you know, we don't do paving, but we can look at all those issues.
Councilor Amaro.
Yeah. First of all, I think we should all realize we're talking about a project that is more than $500,000 by the time we pay off the bond. And we're talking about 4 cents in the first year, but that's the first year of any bond. You know, you don't have the full cost of the interest. When we as a council discussed this earlier on, we were talking about a project between $150,000, $175,000 and maybe $200,000, $225,000. Now that we've got a project of the size that we're talking about, I personally would like to see some other options. I think we're rushing into the project without seeing what some of the other possibilities are. I want to address the safety issues. I want to provide adequate working rooms and areas for our employees. But I have a real problem with the safety issues surrounding the traffic areas. And what Ed Capano brought up tonight, you know, maybe we're being a little short-sighted in our long-range planning. I know the Municipal Facilities Committee did come in with the recommendation that the addition and the improvements to the Public Works garage be in that spot. But I'm not sure whether you looked at the possible expansion of the schools while you were looking at the total municipal facilities for the future. And beyond that, I guess I'm not overly enthused about the design. And I really would like to see what some other possibilities are. So I guess I'm not prepared tonight to vote for this project as it's presented.
Other comments? Councilor Pearson.
I was just trying to get things together here before I babbled. I too, you know, I like the work that the Facilities Committee did and also that Design Alliance did. But and I don't know what went on behind closed doors, if you will, with Bob Malley and the other principals and partners as far as coming up with designs from a simple addressing the code deficiencies and expanding certain facilities to a whole new building, or whether just said, okay, here's the problem, here's the solution, not here's best case, here's the Shangri-La or the whole deal, here's the basic solution. I like to see more than one option presented on any presentation. If this is the dream version that was thought of by either the Facilities Committee and or Bob Malley, then great. And, you know, I don't want to take away from that, but I still want to have an option, and I think the public wants to have an option to see what other possibilities there are. You know, if we could do this, if we could do a different facade, if we could do a different roof line, if we could do a different building, just some kind of total package. The other thing that I mean, if this is also going to stall the code issues being addressed, I'd love to say let's approve the funds, and any that we don't spend, invest in CDs, earning a better rate than we're paying on the bonds, but I don't think that's legal. So I won't suggest that. So I'll stop babbling there.
Okay, during our workshop, there was some discussion by Mr. Stallman and I believe Bob Malley about other configurations and whether this was the ultimate design or whether this was a compromise design. Are either one of you willing to? Pardon? Would you like to just kind of fill in that background, because I'm sure it wasn't the first shot.
Share some of my thoughts as we went through this. I think our thrust was to provide a facility within the most economical means that we could come up with. There was lots of other early sketches that we did that were more flamboyant, had different roof lines and different configurations that I think all of us on the design team, as well as working with Mr. McGovern and Mr. Malley, his crew, the thrust was really to provide a very economical, straightforward addition to an existing building that is anything but gorgeous and is a pretty nuts and bolts building to begin with. And what we tried to do was to, one, fix up the existing building, two, provide an addition to the building that would complement the architecture of the existing building once the existing building got, you know, a new suit of clothes, which is really a paint job with a Thoraseal type product, rather than to try to reskin the building, which would be more money. Try to put, by reskin I mean to put on another cladding material to the exterior of the building. And to provide an addition, which is concrete block, which it merely has two tons of block on it. We were trying to be pretty frugal, because I think all of us realize what that dollar configuration today means to all of us. There are lots of things we could have done. A new building would be great. We'd love to build a new building. And I think that Mr. McGovern's cost of three times is probably at least where it would be, if not 3.5 to 4 times more expensive than this particular project would be. I don't know whether that's fully addressed all of your concerns with the design, but it was not meant to be a flamboyant design, by any matter of fact.
If I may, I think that was also, you know, the clear direction that came out of the Municipal Facilities Committee. You know, I'm a little bit surprised to hear at the 11th hour that we haven't looked at options. You know, I remember very clearly back at the Municipal Facilities Committee level, you know, you had an enormously talented committee. You had the person responsible for facility construction and design for Hannaford Brothers. you had a landscape architect, you had a building architect, you had a principal in a construction firm, you had a local businessman who's had quite a bit of experience with construction in and around his business. You had an accountant, and you also had a very able chairman. During their facilities planning process, they looked at a number of options. But, you know, the message kept coming back that, you know, we can't build the Taj Mahal, that we can't build, you know, can't afford to do the new building at $1 million X, that, you know, we ought to look at this facility in coordination with some of our public safety facilities, and that's exactly what was done. You know, the reason you don't have options before you tonight, a whole lot of pretty pictures with options, is because a lot of that was looked at the Municipal Facilities Committee with a lot of donated talent, and, you know, we didn't want to expend additional funds to have a professional architect, not the others weren't professional, but one we were paying to come up with whole sorts of additional options that had already been looked at by a very capable group. So, you know, that's the reason why you don't see a whole lot of options before you this evening, is they were looked at by the very talented committee a year or more ago.
Okay, we also had, there was a consideration at one point between a 1,600 square foot office facility and the 2,000 square foot, and they opted for the 2,000 square feet.
Yeah.
Do you want to explain the basic increase in square footage?
Yes, I will. What happened was, and it's actually 2,500 square feet.
It's 2,500.
When the committee looked at it, it was not, I'd say it was not fully accounting for some of the map room storage space, some of the space that's lost in hallways, in some of those type areas. You know, I think, you know, as we look at other building projects in the community, you know, I think people sitting around a table, you know, come up with one conclusion, and what you really need to do is to turn it over to someone professional design who's got to look at all the codes and look at all the issues. This firm has done that. And looking at the square footage, you know, I think if you look at the particular features of the building, you'll notice, for example, the shower facilities. We're not looking at, you know, big shower facilities. We're looking at a shower stall. You know, we have really tried to compromise on space. During the latest planning process, we squeezed it back about three times, even to get to the square footage that we're now at. And basically, the increase was as a result of meeting code compliance issues for doorway widths and for other similar areas, rooms in front of lavatories to meet the disabilities design. Even with this plan, the code enforcement officer, who hasn't seen final designs, raised some concerns that you better really look at this particular aspect of again to make sure that you have fully met the footage requirements. So, you know, the codes, once you get into them, you find that you know, to accomplish what you want to accomplish, it just takes additional square feet.
Okay, you were asked by a couple of town councilors to provide information to just barely answer to repair the code deficiencies, and you came up with I'm sure it's more of an educated guess than an actual calculated figure, but then you went on to say that there were 9 different issues that would not be addressed by this particular expenditure, which we're not even sure how we'd fund at the moment. Would we need, just to do the basic code deficiency repair, any kind of approval from other town boards?
I do not believe so, but that's, you know, we'd have to check. There's nothing changing the exterior.
Other comments? Councilor Reed.
Yes, Madam Chairman, just so I can be clear on this, if we were to vote to approve up to $400,000 in the bond for this project, and all of that $400,000 was not used, that would simply buy down the bond, would it not? Dollar
yes.
for dollar?
Yes.
So our role here tonight could be to approve the bond, let the planning board make its determination as to project design, and then we would have final say over the bids that came in and the contractor.
That's correct.
I'm prepared to make a motion.
All right.
I make a motion that we approve as part of the draft bonding resolution submitted by bond council, $400,000 for the Public Works garage.
I'll second that with the qualifications, if I may. I'd just like to make a comment with my second.
Then we can have discussion. You want to discuss?
I'll second it.
Okay.
Now can I make my comment?
Yes, you may.
I would just like to say that I think the garage is in the right place. I'm not one in favor of moving it up to the transfer station because I think the idea of the committee, which I was on at the time it was built, that if we centralized it, your school buses, your fire equipment, police cars, and everything is right there handy, and it's not a trip to another area of the town. And I think the design that they got, I believe it's a good design, but I feel that we could save a few bucks around the outside of that building and come in a little cheaper than what they've got proposed here. There's $103,000 with a guesstimate here just to clear up the problems of the deficiency within the building. So I guess the building itself, as I would take it, would cost maybe $100,000, $150,000. Maybe it's $200,000. But I would like to see it go forward, but I'd like to have another chance. If they can go over the fort and plant a tree and grade the lawn, they certainly ought to be able to do it around the highway garage.
Any other Council Perelman?
I'd just like to make some comments about the money story here, because I think if there's any, you know, joint feeling on the part of the council, it's the feeling that Mr. Hall has spoken about this evening from the point of view of the economy, the recession that we're in, the difficulties that everyone is having these days balancing their budgets. The town manager has indicated to us that in his proposed budget for fiscal year 1992 that considerable sacrifices are going to be made if this bond is approved in order to provide a safe and sanitary work environment for our employees that are providing direct services every day to our citizens. We haven't begun the budget deliberations yet at all. However, what at least has been proposed from the point of view of Public Works is lopping off an equipment operator, reducing road resurfacing by $20,000, reducing sidewalk repairs by $8,000, reducing major road repairs and projects by $78,000, no replacement of a Public Works truck at $70,000, and eliminating a Public Works computer at $5,000. All of that is pulled out of a Public Works budget that is proposed to go down in fiscal year 92 from 27% of our municipal budget to 24%, essentially. So I guess what I'm trying to say is that although this isn't necessarily at all what's going to happen in the context of the budget process, Public Works is proposed to be taking an incredible hit. The hit that it's going to take, as a matter of fact, is going to come out to about a minus 26%. The Public Works basically will be spending $200,000 less in fiscal year 92 than they had spent in fiscal year 1991, the current fiscal year that we're in. That's if all of the particular proposed budget for Public Works actually becomes, etched in granite.
My own personal feeling is that in talking with Bob and in talking with a variety of people, that we can probably do this for less than $400,000. I mean, that seems to be a general, you know, unwritten sentiment. There seems to be about $25,000 in what I call fluff, from the point of view of bleachers and the fence and some trees and miscellaneous reductions and contingencies. That's $25,000 right there. And in this particular climate, with the way bids are happening, people are throwing around numbers like maybe we could get another 25 or another even 50, so that we might be able to even create what we want to be able to create for the safety and sanitary features for maybe $325,000 to $350,000 and not the $400,000. On the other hand, bonding money isn't play money. I mean, it's not like Monopoly. It's going to cost us $22,000 in fiscal year 1992, just in interest alone. No principal is even touched. In fiscal year 93, when we start paying the principal, then we're talking $65,000, 1993. So we can't make believe that it's not going to cost us anything. And I think Councilor Amaro's already made the point that we're really talking in excess of $500,000 for this project once you add up all the interest over the next 10 years in your bonding process. I think that's the problem we have before us tonight. No one wants to deny the Public Works employees an appropriate place to do their work for the citizens of Cape Elizabeth. I think the traffic study issues hopefully can get ironed out in the planning board. But is there any way that we can, as you know, Councilor Reed has proposed, up to $400,000, if we don't need the $400,000, if we really try to create a very lean, a very mean building project, so to speak, can we do it for less and then not be obligated to spend the money from the point of view of the chronology that we would be going through in the bonding process? Is there any way we can get the bids out, take the best bid, reduce the fluff, and perhaps come under the proposed project by, say, $75,000? I ask that to the town manager.
Yeah. I think you're dreaming when you think of 3.25. I think you've gone a little too low. I think, you know, as you look at just addressing the deficiencies alone at over $100,000, you know, to build a 2,500 plus or minus square foot building, and to do those site plans for 3.25, even with real good bids, you know, you're really taking a chance, because we have the particular issue this year is say we bonded 3.25 and came in over. A lot of other years, I can usually turn and say to Bob, you know, let's not do as much paving this year, let's not do this. This particular budget, the money's not going to be there. You know, the budget is almost $300,000 less than it was last year. We don't have the flexibility that we usually have. So, you know, as we go into this whole budget process, I have tried not to have a lot of wishful thinking, hope for the best type approach. I think, you know, during economic times, one of the most important things you have to do is to be fiscally responsible in realizing what something's going to cost and to fund it appropriately. With that said, I do think that 375 is an amount that we could do it within. I think, you know, the fence was mentioned, we could do with a few less trees, we, you know, could cut corners here and there, we could see how we could use Public Works a little bit more. 350 really gets into the questionable. You know, we might get lucky and be able to do it for that, we might not, and then what happens? Whatever you proposed for a bond, if you did approve one, we would not automatically spend it. You know, I think if you look at previous construction projects the town has had, particularly the sewer project, which is the largest one we had, very large sum of money, well over $400,000 was left unspent and went back towards reduction of principal. In this case, it would be the same thing, that, you know, if you did 400, if you did 375, it came below that. Any amount left over would go to pay would retire that principal in the first year, which would then be money that would not have to come out of the operating budget.
That answer your question.
It takes away my wishful thinking, but it does answer the question. Thank you, Mr. Manager.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you. I think, you know, the $350,000, $375,000 is certainly more palatable in this day and age. When we look at $400,000, we are looking, as we've said, at 4 cents on the coming year tax rate, and then 11 cents approximately on the following year, then decreasing after that as the amount spent decreases. I'm very inclined to be in favor of this project, the principle of the project. The money, I'm still going to dicker with in my brain as I talk, probably. I think that the Municipal Facilities Committee did a very good job. They were very thorough. I think as a counselor, I sometimes feel, well, gee, I got left out of part of that process. And I think this is what I was hearing from Councilor Pearson, that all of a sudden we've got a proposal before us, and we wonder what has gone on before the proposal got to us. Having worked in an architect's office, I know some of the fun things that you do ahead of time. I can say this, my old boss is here. He'll be up here whomping me. Some of the sketches you do ahead of time, and when I hear us saying, well, maybe we want to go back and have them do some redesigns, my bet is they could do redesigns and go the way we don't want them to go until we're all blue in the face, which is not what we want. I don't think we're going to get a lot of cost savings in looking at this building again, just from what I know the Municipal Facilities Committee had input into this, and from what I've heard Mr. Stallman describe to us this evening. I am very concerned about the safety issues. I will agree with Irv Chapel about the bathroom in that building. We may not have female employees right now, but speaking from experience, being on a run on the wing plow one day last year, yeah, it would have been nice to be able to go in there and go to the bathroom, but no thanks. Yeah, it's not any place that you want to have to go to unless it's a real emergency. There are some real safety issues. I think if we do this, if we say we want to deal only with the outstanding code and safety issues right now, we're putting a patchwork on this building that is a garage. It was built as a garage. We've got an office up there that almost is a jerry-rigged situation. I was at the open house Saturday. Everybody who came in there, from the little kids to the adults, kind of looked and said they were very agreeable to the proposal, and I did discuss the financing with those people. There weren't a lot of people who showed up. We may have had more children than we had adults even, I'm not sure. But when it was explained to the adults who did show up, they understood the need and they were in favor of the expenditure. I think somebody who takes the time out of their Saturday morning to show up has a pretty good voice with me in this respect. I have heard from some other citizens also. They have been in favor of this project, even knowing that it was a $400 price tag and understanding that it was going out to bond. I think Mr. Councilor Jordan will get another crack at this with his money concerns. A lot of those concerns I share, and I think at contract time we put some of these items as options. We'll find a way to get rid of the fence. I'll promise you that.
I'm listening.
Now, Mr. Stallman has just fallen off his chair, but we'll pick him up later. Okay. But we're not going to have a split rail fence. I'll promise you that, too. Okay. I think one thing we have to be concerned about is the amount of ledge we may run into out there. We know there's ledge there. We ran into that when we replaced the fuel tanks. Bob Malley told me this afternoon about all the ledge around those oak trees that you're not going to touch. Okay, good. I think that's one reason that I'm being more comfortable with the $400,000. If we get out there and we have to do those expenditures for ledge and it's not covered in the bond, it's not going to be an easy year, as the manager has said, to find the money anywhere else. I've heard a concern that, well, if we fund this, maybe we're taking away from a school program. My reply to that is we have talked to the school department. I think they and the public are very well aware, and if they're not, they should be, of the amount that we expect their budget to come into. I do not expect that school department to come in here and cry to us about their programs. They are to deal with that on their own. We are to deal with their bottom line budget figure. And I don't want to get caught into some of the emotional upheavals we had with that last year. End of that discussion. I think that this is something that is farsighted, which this town should pride itself on. We are a farsighted town. We look ahead at things. This is something that is really needed. It is not a Cadillac project. I'm not going to compare it to any other car, but I'll tell you it's not a Cadillac project, and it's something that I'm going to vote in favor of.
Other comments? Council Pearson.
Just a quick. I wanted to qualify. I don't feel left out.
I didn't want to put words in your mouth.
No,
I couldn't
because,
tell.
I mean, as far as building and construction, I know more than I care to know about cost and everything, having been in that industry for 10 plus years. So that doesn't bother me. But it's anyone that's out there in this audience or at home that may have that feeling, because that's whom I'm answering to, and not just my personal opinion, whether it be my expertise or anything else. So you got to touch all bases, and that's simply what I'm doing, as fairly and honestly as possible.
Thank you. Mr. Jordan had his hand up first.
If I may, I just want to say to Janet, it all depends on how bad that facility needs to be used. It would work.
Okay, Mr. Jordan. To the point, please.
What I just want to say is, I heard the words I wanted to hear tonight, and I had understood them in my mind, but I wanted them to come out that if we go for the $400,000, what is not used within the project is going to be used to reduce the cost of the project. That's what I wanted to hear coming up, because we're right here, sitting here tonight, trying to answer questions the same as I worked on last Thursday night with the jail committee, trying to find $2 million, and they still haven't got it bidded to find out of anything that they could take off. And this is why I feel we are here at this point, and I'm not convinced that this can't be built for less than the $400,000.
Thank you. Councilor Creelman.
I just had one question, Bob. Could you estimate for us roughly how many people came by in total, both with the Saturday morning two-hour opportunity as well as before that particular time? How many citizens came by to view the garage?
We had two come in on Friday because they couldn't make it before. On Saturday, we had approximately 20 people that came in. We had about five kids that came with their fathers to just view the equipment, I think, and take a look around. We had four of the firemen come up that were generally interested, I think, in what we wanted to do. My wife came up, feel sorry for me. And I think we had about five or six people that were genuinely interested in the project, that had concerns about it, as Council McLaughlin said, that felt when they left that they had a better understanding of the project and what we were going to do. So about six people.
Thank you.
Councilor Reed.
I just would like Councilor Creelman to know that I took an entire up the stairs and everything about 2 months ago, so I've also seen it.
Okay, I believe we'll take a roll call vote on this item. I think that Mr. McGovern realizes that the consensus of the council is that when this, if passed, goes out to bid, that you will have the bidding process structured in such a way that there are options.
The architect is shaking his head.
Thank you, Mr. Stock. All right, we'll take a roll call vote.
Chairman Comstock?
Yes.
Councilor Amaral?
No.
Councilor Creelman?
Yes.
Councilor Jordan?
Yes.
Councilor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Councilor Pearson?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And Councilor Reed?
Yes.
It's a 6-1 vote. And now for the second part of the item, which is the draft bonding resolution.
And instead of reading the entire resolution as presented, I would like a motion that would make reference to, I believe it's 1, 2, 3, 4 pages that was presented by bond counsel.
Madam Chairman, I move that we approve that we authorize the combined bond issue for capital projects. These projects to include miscellaneous school repairs at $422,500, portable classrooms at $115,000, Portland Headlight Keepers Quarters and Museum, there's Henry, $285,000, the acquisition, improvement, and equipping of property located at 1226 Shore Road, $200,000, improvements to the Public Works Facility, $400,000.
Is there a second?
I would second the draft bonding resolution by our excellent counsel.
Any discussion? Mr. McGough.
Yeah, just for purposes of clarification, the miscellaneous school repairs are the repairs that were done last summer. These are not new repairs. The portable classrooms are the portable classrooms that were built last summer. The Portland Headlight Keepers Quarters Museum is the money that as well was previously proposed and approved by the council. Those three items, what we tried to do was make an omnibus bond resolution. Those three were early approved. 1226 Shore Road, there was all sorts of discussion, and there seemed to be an approval of it, but it was not in the correct form and really spelled out in the bond form, and this Public Works one you're well aware of.
All those in favor of the motion? It's a 6-1 vote.
You didn't even let her put a hand on it.
Those who do not agree. Thanks. Don't want to deny you the right to raise your hand. On to the next item, public hearing on setbacks. I'll ask Council McLaughlin, who's chairman of the Ordinance Committee, to please give us background.
Just a moment.
I know we have a lot of papers.
Too many papers. Thank you, Madam Chairman. The Council Ordinance Committee, the Board of Zoning Appeals, and the Planning Board and town staff have all worked on what is before the Council tonight for revisions to sections of the setback ordinances. There are basically four or five, I guess, major revisions being proposed. One is that in business districts, that there, when a lot abuts a residential district, the side and the rear setbacks shall be 50 feet rather than 25 feet. The part of the new language that I call the common sense language, or the Susie Tarion edition and Bill Jordan edition, deals with having a building, usually a residence, any building having a residence on a road that is, it's an older residence on one of the early roads in town. If the residence was built within the setbacks at that time, it now may, with the setbacks having doubled, your house may be totally within your front yard setback. And if you want to put a rear addition on, you can't do it. What this revised language would allow is if you can show that when your home was built, it met the setbacks, and that any proposed rear addition, which you could also swing around on the side, could have today's setbacks, either side or front setback, reduced by 50%, basically putting it back to what it was when the house was built, most likely. A third item is, with setbacks for decks, they may be reduced by the board, providing that by the Board of Zoning Appeals, provided that the conditional use standards are met and that the height of the deck above average grade does not exceed 10 feet. Also recommending a revision, an addition in section 19.3.2, which deals with non-conforming lots, to make the reduction of lot size there applicable to all non-conforming lots. That had was basically a typo back when it was dealt with some other time. Also proposing to add a definition for deck, that deck be defined as an open platform.
Thank you. Is there anyone who wishes to make a statement on the new setback changes? There being none, I'll close the part of the public hearing and we'll move on to our discussion of item 133 to consider public hearing comments on proposed amendments to the zoning ordinance regarding setbacks and take any necessary action. Councilor Reed.
Yes, Madam Chairman, I was wondering if I could ask the Ordinance Committee for a broader definition of deck than open platform. Does that have sides and rails and things? It just doesn't have a roof?
I'm going to defer answering that and ask Mr. McVane to reply to that, if he would, please.
Thank you.
Mr. McVane is the code enforcement officer for the town.
Yes. We went with an open platform definition because it, or raised platform, because it would separate it from patios. And it also being open means it doesn't have a roof. It may have a handrail, but it wouldn't have a roof over it. We felt that, and that was Webster's definition, we felt that it best fit the application.
Other questions? There being none, I'll take a motion on this item.
Madam Chairman, I move that we approve the proposed revisions and additions to section 19.3.1, 19.3.2 of the ordinance.
I'll second that motion.
And 19.1.3, excuse me.
I'll second that motion. I would like to ask the chairman to interpret on section 19.3-2A. If you read that paragraph, I'm not going to ask you to read it out loud because I don't think you'd understand it either when you get down.
You looking for an answer?
No, we'll let it go. It's in the. It's been in there for a long time, but I don't see how anybody understands it.
It is translatable.
It is?
It is, right.
Well, I need to hire a lawyer to do it.
Ernie can do it.
Ernie can do it.
Do you want Mr. McVane to address that, or can he enjoy his comment?
All those in favor of the motion? The 7-0. On to item number 134, to consider a recommendation from the Fort Williams Committee. Advisory Commission, regarding the use of Fort Williams Park for graduation activities for the Cape Elizabeth High School class of 1991 and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern, would you like to just make a comment on this?
Yes. As you note from the materials from the Fort Williams Commission, Advisory Commission, this was approved by them back at their meeting on January 10th, 1991. It would provide for graduation on Friday the 14th from about 2 p.m. to 10 p.m. Graduation itself would be from 2 to 4 on the parade ground. Students would then return homes to visit with family, and then there'd be a cookout at the picnic shelter from 6 to 10 p.m. It is proposed that access to the fort on this particular evening be limited to the class and their invited guests. With the one exception of those folks who would want to be there to be set up for family fun day, which will be the next day. The setup should work a little bit better this year in that the senior class activity will be at the picnic shelter, which will be removed at that time of day from the parade ground area. But the commission does recommend approval.
Comments? A motion?
Councilor
Jordan. Councilor Jordan?
A lot of movement over here.
I was just going to move the question, but other people got ahead of me, so I'll second it.
All those in favor?
I've got a question. In the minutes from the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, I see that they're asking for 2 p.m. to 10 p.m. In the letter addressed to the council, they're asking for 4 p.m. till 10 p.m. I'm assuming it's two. Okay, I just want to make sure that's clear in whatever we approve here, or else Lord knows where you'll have to have graduation. I also appreciate you not asking us to ensure that you're going to have sunshine this year. We didn't do real well with that last year, but quasi.
Any further? Councilor Amaro.
No, I just wondered if there were, if anybody was here from the high school.
Would you
Seeing
like
that
to,
there is, maybe.
Would you like to come up to the microphone, please?
I'm Stephanie Spencer, and I'm one of the co-chairs of the graduation committee, and I can answer any questions you might have.
Are there any specific questions?
Well, all I can say is a very nice letter, and I understood it, and I wish you the best, and I hope you have sunshine, and maybe the fog won't roll in this year.
Thank you very much.
Councilor Amaro.
Yeah, I also was really pleased in your letter that you emphasized the fact that the graduating class considers their graduation a community event and welcomes the community to participate, et cetera. I think that's a terrific attitude, and maybe many community members will. I hope they will.
Hopefully. Further comments? Councilor Kramer.
We're delighted that you're going to be using the fort again for graduation. You've certainly underscored in your letter the involvement of SAD members, the involvement of the whole intent that it be alcohol-free. And I'm sure that I speak for the council in endorsing the project graduation with the hope that it does indeed remain alcohol-free.
Other comments? All those in favor of the motion? Opposed, there being none. 7-0. Hope you have a good day, Stephanie. Item number 135, to consider a recommendation from the Fort Williams Advisory Commission regarding the use of Fort Williams Park by the Fort Lee Symphony Orchestra on July 3rd, 12th, and 26th, 1991, and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, you have before you a letter from the Symphony which confirms a discussion that the Fort Williams Commission had on January 10th, 1991. The major change from last year is that the parking would be $2 rather than $1, and to reduce congestion, parking fees would not be collected at the gate. The Symphony does have some concern with the increase in cost, and I have built into the municipal budget that you're receiving later this evening officially an assumption that the parking fees will be $2 rather than $1.
And also in the letter that they will limit the number of people to 5,000 for each event.
That's correct. There was a major traffic problem on July 3rd of 1990, and the Symphony clearly understands that that's not to be repeated.
I'll take a motion. Councilor McLaughlin.
I have a question first. Is there anybody from the Symphony here tonight? I don't think so. I'm curious. I fully agree with us raising the parking charge to $2. I would hope that the Symphony does not add that to every ticket, because very often people will carpool. I would hope that they would sell parking tickets per car, and you could purchase that along with your Symphony tickets. We also have a good number of residents in this town who can walk to these concerts, and I would hate to think that they have to pay the $2 parking charge. So perhaps that could be passed on to the Symphony folks. That's my preference anyway.
Is there a motion? Councilor Amaro?
They used to sell family tickets. I don't know if they still do that.
They did that last year.
So that would help somewhat. Mm-hmm.
Councilor Jordan?
I have a question to the manager. The $2 parking deal, does that take care of the public works and the people that have to work there, or do you charge over and above that?
We charge the Symphony directly over and above for all direct costs for police, public works, fire, and portable toilets.
So, and that's $2. I hedge on that.
I believe we have already voted on increasing the parking fee.
That was in the statement of uses that you adopted last month, I believe.
I'll take a motion on this item, please.
I'd move that we accept the recommendation from the Fort Williams Advisory Commission regarding the use of Fort Williams Park by the Portland Symphony Orchestra on July 3rd, 12th, and 26th, 1991.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor? Against one. 6-1. Item number 136, to consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding a proposed signed ordinance and take any necessary action. I'll turn the floor over to Councillor McLaughlin, who is chairman of the Ordinance Committee.
Thank you, Madam Chair. The Council received this evening an addendum memo relating to the sign ordinance. And I would request that you have that out along with your sign ordinance as I go through it. I will preface going through the sign ordinance by saying that a lot of people have put energy and time into this. The Planning Board has reviewed this, has had a public hearing since our public hearing in November. We've incorporated a lot of very valid points made by the Planning Board members, by town staff, primarily the manager, the planner, and the code enforcement officer, and from the public that we heard from at our public hearing on November 14th. What I would like to do tonight is go through the ordinance with the council, explaining some of the changes that have been made since you last saw it, in hopes that what we end up with at the end of our session this evening will be what we want to put to public hearing at next month's meeting. It may feel a little bit like an ordinance committee meeting, but I really want everybody to understand it, especially with some of the changes that are being presented to you this evening. The majority of these changes are for clarity's sake. There's very little substantive changes being made this evening. If there were more substantive changes, I would be reluctant to proceed this evening, but I think there's enough that we can get through it. If anybody has a problem with that, even as we're going through it, we can do some postponing if that's what people are comfortable with. On the first page, we have a new purpose statement, and a lot of this was in an effort to make the purpose statement more meaningful and to make it coincide with the rest of the language in the ordinance. Just to set the stage, I'd like to read the purpose statement. It is that the purpose of this ordinance is to govern the placement and maintenance of signs, promote signs in keeping with the town character, discourage excessive signs by minimizing the number and size of signs, eliminate intrusive sign lighting, and encourage structurally sound and well-maintained signs in the interest of the health, safety, and general welfare of the residents of Cape Elizabeth. That's basically what we're trying to do with this ordinance, as well as getting rid of things that we found were too difficult to enforce. That will be the reason for some of the changes since this council last saw it. We've added a definition of banner, which is slightly revised in your addendum to read, a banner shall mean a sign on a textile or plastic material which is secured to a pole or structure in a fashion which may allow movement by the atmosphere. It doesn't have to be out there flapping in the breeze. It can be a textile or plastic material affixed to a building, such as what is currently up for a Fleet Bank sign. That would be called a banner. We've added a definition for message boards, permanent or temporary sign designed for or operated with changeable copy, but shall not include a gasoline price per gallon sign. On the second page, there's been a revision to the definition for roof signs. Now, a roof sign would be a sign where more than 50% of the surface area extends directly above the roof or parapet line of a building. That is a very different definition than what we had previously. That will also come into play when we are talking about prohibited signs. We've added a definition for measuring the sign area. I'm not going to totally read that one. It's quite lengthy. It basically says the sign area, if it's a wall sign, that it's the perimeter of all the letters on that wall sign, or it's the back where there's a different background color. The dimensions of the sign will not include the supporting structure. That is a change from what we had previously, where it did include the supporting structure. There is a revised definition for temporary signs in what was passed out tonight. I had discussions with ordinance committee members and the planner about this. Temporary sign being defined, and the length of time a temporary sign is displayed. If you have a temporary sign up for even half hour of a day, it is considered being up for the entire day. That comes into play later when we talk about how long a temporary sign can be displayed. I think those are the major changes in the definition section. In Article 2, we're talking about permitted signs. Towards the bottom of page 3 in subsection E, there is slight revision for clarity for language about garage sale, yard sale signs, saying that they may go up 24 hours before the first day of your sale and would need to come down 24 hours after the last day of your sale. Make sure I'm in the right place. Okay. Next change. Okay, thank you. On page 4, subsection J, these are permitted signs again, that no trespassing, no dumping, subsection J, no trespassing, no dumping, private road signs, and signs of a similar intent are allowed. And they shall not exceed 2 square feet per exposed face. We added the words of a similar intent. That was a question from one of the ordinance committee members. Signs allowed with a permit for a temporary residential development or construction sign may be put up after the planning board has given approvals for that development. And the size has changed, been reduced to 36 feet for that kind of sign.